trustees.
This is it.
Thank you, Vivian.
Sure.
Yeah, I didn't have to tell you which one it was.
It was the only PowerPoint
on
there.
One,
yeah. So let's just do a switch. Let's see. Eject. Okay. Here you are.
And then.
And it's right here.
Yep.
We'll bring it up. Right now, you're the only PowerPoint that I'm aware of. I'm just going to make that full screen.
How do you make it full screen? You can close it. Yeah.
F5. And then actually, what I'll do is. Do that, because that's right now you're the only one that I know of.
So come up here and hit F5.
You just hit 2,
okay.
And then you can go back to 3, and it'll go to the camera.
Right.
So there you go, and
so
then
come up
just
and hit F2, and then we're done.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order on Monday, December the 5th at 7:01 p.m. and certainly want to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. As we take a moment of solemn meditation, I would just like to ask if you might remember, we had two great university leaders to pass in the last week. One was Chancellor Deborah Saunders White at NCCU, and the other was Dr. Keith Brody. Some of you may not had an opportunity to attend the services. I was at NCCU and Duke this evening. So as we take this moment of silent meditation, if you could remember those two persons, it would be appreciated. Thank you. Thank you. I would ask Councilman Davis if he would.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We are honored to have several scouts from Troop 439 from the Bahama Ruatan Club to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance tonight.
Madam Clerk, would you call the roll, please?
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. Councilmember Davis. Councilmember Johnson.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
Councilmember Reese.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
I'd like to ask if the members of the Keep Durham Beautiful Board, if they're here, if they would join me at the podium, if you don't mind, and also the staff. Here's fine. I think after we finish, we'll go down into the well. Oh, come on up here, if you don't mind. I mean, if you want to sit down, that's fine. This is huh? This evening, we have the opportunity to recognize Keep Durham Beautiful for its Environmental Stewardship Award Keep Durham Beautiful will be helping the city of Durham to increase our green infrastructure and urban tree canopy and through a grant that has been provided by Duke Energy Foundation. The grant implementation is a partnership between the city of Durham staff from the Department of General Services and Keep Durham Beautiful. And the grant from Duke Energy Foundation will provide $80,000 to allow our city staff and Keep Durham Beautiful to engage Durham's civic, business, and residential partners to renew the urban tree canopy in identified areas of East Durham. As environmental awareness campaign and urban tree summit will accompany the urban tree restoration program, which altogether will provide volunteer opportunities that engage residents and civic organizations to build quality of life by cooling our streets and homes in the area, especially during the summer, by reducing energy use and filtering pollutants from the air and water. And the diversity of the tree species will enable wildlife habitat and protect water quality in Durham's critical Ellerbee Creek watershed. This is an effort that is greatly appreciated by certainly the city of Durham and hopefully the residents of East Durham. And we like to talk about a lot of things happening in our community through partnerships. And this is another great example of partnership between the public sector being the city and the private sector being Duke Energy. And I'd like to ask Ms. Indira Everett, who's the manager of Duke Energy for our area, if she would join me, if you don't mind, Indira. And in this case, I guess we need to go into the canopy, but why don't you come up and make some comments and we can go down when we do that.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, council members, staff, and all those in attendance tonight. Tonight, I'm proud to represent Duke Energy and award its first ever grant, as you heard, in the amount of $80,000 to keep Durham beautiful. I'd like to thank you all for your leadership in ensuring the city and Duke Energy continues to closely work together as we have in open communication and transparency as it relates to our vegetation management practices. I've observed your staff all year, their commitment and their passion, and that is one of the reasons that I was so proud to advocate for this grant during our recent cycle. At Duke Energy, we care about and value the efforts to build the community at large, and that is certainly exhibited within your staff. Today's award is an extension of the partnership we enjoy. Our staff looks forward to participating in the upcoming Durham Tree Summit, where best practices for caring for trees will be shared with the community. Again, I want to say a special congratulations, and I look forward to our continued collaboration on ways to better serve the citizens and the residents of Durham. And so at this time, I have an official check that I will give Tanya. Make sure I give that to the right person, and then I do have a check for a check presentation that I'd like to present to you.
Mayor Pro Tem. We unfortunately have lost another colleague, a former city council person in the past week, and We like to present a resolution. I would ask the Mayor Pro Tem if she would present it. Are members of the family here?
Are Cynthia's family members here or friends? If you would join me, please. Up here, please.
I didn't have the privilege of, come on up, please. I didn't have the privilege of serving with Cynthia when she was a member of the City Council, but I certainly worked with her when I was on the Board of County Commissioners and in the community. So we're very pleased with her contributions to the City of Durham, even when she wasn't on the City Council, and sorry to hear about her passing. And this is a resolution that we'd like to present to friends and family, and ask the Mayor Pro Tem if she would do that.
I had the honor of being a city employee when Cynthia was a city council member, and she was an awesome leader. The larger resolution will be coming later, so I'm just reading it now. Resolution memorializing Cynthia Denise Brown. Whereas Cynthia Denise Brown was born in New York, New York, on October 9, 1958, to the late Laverne Martin Brown and Robert Brown, and the eldest of six children. Whereas later in life, she became a resident of Reidsville, North Carolina, received her undergraduate degree in political science from Bennett College in Greensboro, and her master's of public affairs from the University of North Carolina in Greensboro. And whereas immediately upon completion of her graduate studies, she became the assistant director in a shelter for battered women and their children in Greensboro, and subsequently shelter director in High Point, North Carolina. And whereas she used her training to increase grassroots community people's capacity to build their own organizations, build effective alliances, and advocate for public policies that address their needs, and served on the Greensboro Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the Resourceful Communities Program, and the AIRS Program. And whereas for the last six years, as a trainer with Dismantling Racism training team, Cynthia continued to address the impact racism, sexism, classism, heterosexism, and homophobia had on undermining the work for justice. And where Cynthia was a former Durham City Council member serving from December 1995 to December 1999, a 2002 U.S. senatorial candidate, and co-chaired the first U.S. Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Greensboro from June 2004 to May 2006. And whereas, while residing in Lexington, Kentucky, she was leadership program director, then interim executive director for Southeast Women's Employment Coalition. And whereas, her affiliations and honors are many, just to name a few. Highlander Research and Education Center board member, process observer for the African National Congress during South African elections, board member of the Women's Center Substance Abuse Prevention Agency, the Institute for Southern Studies, the NC Coalition on Black and Brown Civic Participation, of which she was a founding member, the Latino Community Development Center, the NC Conservation Network, and she was the principal consultant of the Sojourner Group, a business that she founded to help nonprofit groups to strengthen their leadership and their organizational development issues. And whereas Cynthia served on numerous boards, received numerous awards, and was a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority. And whereas, as a W.K. Kellogg National Fellow, she studied cultural, racial, and economic justice issues in Australia, Brazil, Guatemala, South Africa, Ghana, Egypt, Chile, and other places, and whereas she worshiped at the St. Paul United Methodist Church while she was a resident of Reidsville, North Carolina, where she learned strong Christian values that guided her through life. And upon her relocation to Durham, she became a member of Russell Memorial Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. And whereas Cynthia Denise Brown will be long remembered for her conscientiousness, distinctive diligence, and unselfish service, a woman who provided exceptional leadership to numerous civic, religious, educational, and other organizations throughout her career. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Durham City Council that this City Council pauses in a moment of silence in memory of Cynthia Denise Brown. That this governing body pays tribute to the life of Cynthia Denise Brown and the unselfish contribution she made to the city of Durham and other communities. That this resolution be spread upon the official minutes of this governing body. That a certified copy of this resolution be presented to the family of Cynthia Denise Brown.
Would one of you like to say something? And the larger resolution will be coming later, and we'll let you know when it's ready.
I will not take very much time. I'd just like to thank you, the City Council, for this great opportunity and for honoring our niece, Cynthia Brown. Thank you very much.
Let me ask, are there comments by members of the council? Councilman Reese. Yeah, sure.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a couple of announcements. First and foremost, I want to congratulate you, Mr. Mayor, on having been named to the Order of the Longleaf Pine this past Thursday here in Durham. This is the most prestigious award that a North Carolinian can receive from the state of North Carolina, and honors those who have a proven record of service to our state. Mr. Mayor, it is well past time that you be so honored. Congratulations, sir. Mr. Mayor, as you may well be aware, as a member of the Order of the Longleaf Pine, you have the special privilege to propose the official toast of the great state of North Carolina in select company anywhere in the free world. If you choose to do that now, it would be great. Maybe next time. Second, this past Saturday, December 3rd, 30 lucky young children here in Durham were given a very special Christmas gift, a shopping spree, thanks to the work of our Durham County Fraternal Order of Police. This year's annual Cops and Kids event brought together officers from the Durham Police Department and deputies from the Durham County Sheriff's Office to help these 30 kids do some Christmas shopping at Target. The organizers of the event raised money from private donations to provide $150 for each child to spend on themselves for Christmas. Sadly, for two of these lucky kids, they were accompanied on their shopping spree by this rookie member of the City Council, but somehow they still managed to have a good time. And for the record, Baby Alive dolls are still quite popular with the kids today. It was a really great event. Lastly, and this is the last thing I'm gonna say, today is very nearly the 1 year anniversary of the first time I ever sat in this chair and I joined the Durham City Council. For nearly a year, actually, it's 363 days, but who's counting? I have worked as hard as I know how to earn the trust and confidence that the people of this city have placed in me. And the most important thing I've learned in my first year on the City Council really it's two things. Number one, how little I knew when I took this oath a year ago. And number two, how much I still have to learn about how to serve this incredible city we all love. And so as I honor this, my first year of service, I wanted to add a special note of appreciation to the two folks up here who have served our city the longest on the City Council, Mayor Bell and my seatmate, Mayor Pro Tem Coracle McFadden. I'm so grateful for the two of you for your leadership and for the benefit of your wisdom, and I'm incredibly glad that I'll have at least one more year to serve with the two of you, because did I mention I still have a lot to learn? I appreciate your indulgence, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Charlie, and I think you've done an admirable job as a member of this council, and I appreciate your service, your efforts, and I know we'll continue to see that, so thank you. Is that Pro Tem? You have a comment?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
I just wanted to take this time to thank all of our city employees for the hard work that you do. You are the ones who keep the city rolling, stable, and we really appreciate all that you do. So let's give them a round of applause. And their fearless leader. I have a special appreciation for city employees because I was a city employee at one time. And it is really a blessing and a privilege to serve my hometown right now. Thank you.
Well, it's interesting. Well, I'm just going to, since the Mayor Pro Tem mentioned about city employees, I was at my home on Thanksgiving Day and looked out my window and saw some city employees across the street. Evidently, one of my neighbors had had problems with their sewer outfall, and these guys were out here to the rescue. And I, in fact, I went out to find out why they were there. Yeah, it's a while, but they told me what they got a call, and they said they need to come out, so they were there. Recognize Councilman Mock.
Thank you. I'm going to follow up on those comments too, and particularly I want to lift up the our Parks and Recreation Department. This is a busy time of year for them. I went to Centerfest on Saturday, and I was amazed at how many people were there. I've heard an estimate of six. Oh, I'm sorry. What did I say?
Centerfest.
Oh, I'm sorry. I got the first letter wrong. Winterfest, and I'm thinking too far ahead. The Winterfest, which was on Saturday, was out at the stadium. I've heard an estimate there were 6,000 to 7,000 people there, and that what we saw, my daughter was like, "Oh, sledding! I think I'll pass," because there was such a line for every single event, horse rides, s'mores. I mean, there were so many activities, and everybody was patient and happy and having a great time. It was really a wonderful organization. The same department will be putting on our holiday parade this very Saturday. So parade is at 10 o'clock. It'll come down Main Street, essentially just east of Roxboro, all the way to Duke's East Campus. So come down Saturday morning and take in the holiday parade. The mayor has been pushing for this for quite some time, and it's going to happen on Saturday. And finally, the same group will be also putting on an event for seniors here, a huge holiday party that will happen, I think it's next week. So I just want to just acknowledge, in particular at the moment, the Parks and Recreation people, and thank them for everything they're doing to make the holidays so neat for so many of us.
Thanks, Don. Any other comments?
I guess we need to congratulate Wendy Jacobs on her being named chair of the
James Hill.
And James Hill, vice chair of the Board of County Commissioners. Yes.
Thank you. Okay. We'll recognize the city manager for priority items.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everyone. Priority items this evening, agenda item number 14. Fire and police compensation and classification plan recommendations. This item is being referred back to the administration and will be deferred to the December 8th work session discussion.
Entertain a motion on the city manager's part. Been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Recognize city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
And recognize the city clerk.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. We have Mr. Nicholas Coleman this evening joining us. He was recently appointed to the Human Relations Commission, so he's here to be sworn in.
Thank you.
I, Nicholas Coleman,
do hereby solemnly swear,
do hereby solemnly swear,
that I will support and maintain,
that I will support and maintain,
the Constitution and laws of the United States,
the Constitution and laws of the United States,
and the Constitution and laws of North Carolina,
and the Constitution and laws of North Carolina,
not inconsistent therewith,
not inconsistent therewith,
and that I will faithfully and impartially,
and that I will faithfully and impartially, discharge the duties of my office
as a member of the Human Relations Commission.
As a member of the Human Relations Commission.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Thank you.
Nicholas, while you're signing, let me say on behalf of the council, we appreciate your willingness to serve on a very important committee, as are most of our committees. I was impressed by the fact that you're so young and willing to offer your service and time, and we certainly appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, we will begin with the agenda. As you know, the consent agenda items may be approved with a single vote. If a council person chooses to remove an item for discussion, we'll discuss that later in the program, and likewise, if someone from the audience chooses to remove a consent agenda item, we'll discuss that later in the program also, and I'll just read the heading of each one of the consent agenda items. Item one is boards, committees, and commissions attendance reports for the period of July 1, 2015 through June 30th, 2016. Item two is the Durham Workforce Development Board appointment. Item three is street maintenance performance audit for November 2016. Item 14 is a resolution memorializing Cynthia Denise Brown, which you just had read. And item five is a single space parking meter contract. Item six is multi-space parking pay station contract. Item seven is a second contract amendment with Republic Parking Systems, Inc. for parking management services. Item eight is the Durham Orange Light Rail Transportation Project donation of right-of-way. Item nine is roof replacements at various Department of Water Management facilities. Item 10 is asbestos cement waterline replacement. Item 11 is utility easement maintenance tree removal, SR 62 amendment to the contract with L-J Inc. Item 12 is public safety radio replacement capital improvement plan purchase. Item 13 is the Durham Performing Arts Center seating replacement. Item 14 is an item that can be found on the general business agenda and has been referred back as city manager priority. Item 15 is a budget recommendation for 10.01 transformation in 10 initiative. Item 16 is 2016 COPS hiring program grant project ordinance. Items 20 through 27 are items that can be found on the general business agenda as public hearings. And item 31 is an item that can be found on the general business agenda also. We entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda with the exception of item to include item 14, which is being referred back.
So moved.
Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to the general business agenda. Item 14 is fire and police compensation, which has been referred back. Item 31 is the consolidated annexation for Ellis Road townhouses. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yeah, I'm going to make two brief comments about the consent agenda. The first is on the attendance reports for boards, commissions, and commissions. There were 11 people serving on these commissions with attendance under 60%, and they will be getting a letter from our city clerk. We do want people who are on these commissions to actually attend and serve because they're really important to us. The second thing I wanted to do, because we talked about budget for the transformation in 10 initiative, I just wanted to call out the Board of County Commissioners because they've also provided some funding to help pay for a part-time health community worker who'll be in the focus area, and I just wanted to thank them for their collaborative effort.
Well, thank you, Don. We so noted and appreciate it. Okay, if we move to item 31, consolidated annexation for Ellis Road townhouses.
Good evening, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. As the council may recall, this item was continued from the November 21st, 2016 hearing. This is a request for a utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation and plan amendment, and zoning map change for Ellis Road Residential 2. And this is for 4 contiguous acres totaling approximately 25.6 acres, 4 contiguous parcels. The applicant is requested an initial zoning designation plan development residential 7.550 for a maximum of 165 townhouse units. And they are also requesting a change to the future land use map to change the site, which is currently designated as low density residential, to low medium density residential. And I'm happy to answer any questions that the council may have at this time regarding this request.
I recognize Councilman Shule. We do have one person that signed to speak for this item, Laura Hall. I'm about to recognize the Councilman Shule, please.
Mr. Mayor, I'll hold my comments until after the speaker. Thank you.
Laura Holman, is she present?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. Laura Holloman, Spalding and Norris. Here tonight, as want to thank you first and foremost for allowing us to continue our case to allow for some dialogue between myself and the applicant or developer on this as it relates to affordable housing. I spoke with the contract holder for the Ellis Road Townhomes property after the meeting on November 21st. We discussed the project and the goals of the City Council, specifically related to affordable housing. The Ellis Road Townhomes project has agreed to numerous requirements which will serve to benefit the public. Ellis Road will be widened along the property's frontage and turn lanes will be added to access points into the development. Necessary striping will also be undertaken. Further, a bike lane will be added to the frontage of the property. More importantly, an extension of gravity sewer line to the property will be done, allowing an aging pump station to be taken offline. While the townhomes proposed in the Ellis Road Townhomes project are not affordable housing, they present a distinct housing option within the reach of the average homeowner. Townhomes as a product category increase the diversity and affordability of housing options. Single-family homes being built en masse are commonplace in Durham and surrounding areas and have largely approached unaffordable pricing. People who live and work in Durham and RTP often cannot afford the skyrocketing prices of surrounding single-family homes. Townhomes offer a different lifestyle decision and are a less costly alternative to the traditional single-family home. We have previously discussed the commitments to architectural elements that sets this project apart from others. Varied building materials, styles, colors, features, and the like will make the Ellis Road Townhomes project avoid the monotony of repetitive building facades. This project may serve as a benchmark going forward and has been stated as such by both members of the council and the Planning Commission. In addition to the aforementioned commitments, the developer offers the following proffer. The developer shall provide a payment to the City of Durham of $50,000 for the purposes of affordable housing. The payment shall be provided prior to the approval of the final plat. I thank you for your time and consideration, and I'll be more than happy to answer any questions you may have.
Let me ask other questions by members of the council of the applicant. I recognize Councilman Shule.
I don't have a question, Mr. Mayor, but I do want to offer my appreciation to the applicant for that proffer of the donation of the $50,000 appreciate you for taking that back. And I think it's really important that all of our developers be helping us build affordable housing. And I much appreciate your proffer, Ms. Hallman. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other comments, questions? Members of the council.
Yeah, I'm moving on.
I was going to. These are comments. These comments.
No,
I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, you have questions again? Okay. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
All right. Thank you. Let's move to the general business agenda for public hearings. Item 20 is street closing on Huntsman Drive.
Thank you. Jacob Wiggins again with the Planning Department, and I would like to affirm that all legal notice requirements for planning items tonight have been executed in accordance with applicable state and local law, and affidavits are on file with the Planning Department indicating such. This is a request from Robert Shunk with Stewart. He's proposing to close 223.52 linear feet of Huntsman Drive. This right-of-way is currently open, and the portion requested for closure is currently unmaintained. As part of the rezoning process for the Meadows at South Point 2 development, the applicant voluntarily proffered to close this connecting stub. If this request is approved, this right-of-way will be divided equally amongst the two property owners. There are currently no outstanding issues based upon the review of this request, and staff recommends that the council permanently close this 223.52 linear foot portion of Huntsman Drive. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you all may have.
Again, this is a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. I ask the first set of questions by members of the council. If not, we have Mr. Robert Shunk. Comments? 3 minutes.
Mr. Mayor, Mayors of the City Council, I don't have any prepared comments, but I'm available for any questions you might have.
Else who wants to speak on this item, this being a public hearing matter. Let the record reflect that no one else has to speak. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is back before the council.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Item 21 is a street closing for Dickens Lane 2.
Good evening, Kyle Taylor of the Planning Department. Robert Murphy proposes to close 402.05 linear feet of Dickinson Lane. The right-of-way is currently dedicated but not improved. If this request is approved, the adjacent parcels and right-of-way will be combined into one parcel of land with an area of 14.722 acres. There are currently no outstanding issues regarding this request. Staff recommends that council approve the permanent reclosure of 402.05 linear feet of Dickinson Lane. Thank you. I'm available for any questions.
This is a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. Are there questions by council members of the staff? Not to recognize Robert Shunk.
Again, here for any comments, Mayor. Mr. Mayor.
Any comments by members of council, questions on this item? Is there anyone else in the public that wants to speak on this item? Let the record reflect that no one else in the public asked to speak. I would declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
I can move to item 22, zoning map change, ample storage, 5239 North Carolina Highway 55.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor of the Planning Department. Zoning case Z1500041, ample storage, 5239 NC Highway 55 is a rezoning map change request for one parcel of land with land mass of 4.04 acres. The project is located at 5239 North Carolina Highway 55. The subject site is presently zoned commercial neighborhood with future land use designation of commercial. The applicant proposes a designation of commercial general with a development plan. The development plan associated with this request graphically commits to the following: general locations of site access points, street coverage areas, building envelope, size and location of project boundary buffers. The text commitment, there is one text commitment proffered with this application, which limits the use to self-storage. Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 11-0 on October 11th, 2016. And staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans and policies. Thank you. I'm available for any questions.
This is a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. Let me ask other questions by members of the staff. If not, we have one person decided to speak, Neil Gosch. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, and members of the City Council. My name is Neil Gosch. I live at 4 Silverwood Court here in Durham. I'm with the Morningstar Law Group, and I'm here on behalf of Ample Storage for this rezoning tonight. We have with us our engineer, Patty Hildreth with CMS Engineering, and Mr. Terry Wethington, who is with Ample Storage. I know I've met all of you before on an individual basis at some point, but I thought I would take some time to more fully introduce myself, given that this is my first time in front of the entire council. You may know I'm a native of Durham. I grew up in Parkwood, lived in the same townhouse for 20 years until my parents moved to North Durham, where they still live today. I'm a proud product of Durham Public Schools. I went to Parkwood Elementary, Losgrove Middle School, Jordan High School, and in my time here at Durham, I've seen a lot of changes, and I think they've all definitely been very positive. I want to thank you all for being influential in shaping the direction of our city. That being said, I'll get to the matter before you tonight, and I'll try to be brief. I want to thank staff for their presentation and their recommendation, and you should also know that we did receive a unanimous recommendation for approval from the Planning Commission. Not an easy feat these days. I think this is a fairly straightforward rezoning. We're trying to establish a self-storage use on this property, which is a less intense use than what would otherwise be allowed here. The access to the site will be through an existing driveway that will be shared with the adjacent property, and that reduces the amount of curb cuts along Highway 55. We think that's a good thing. Reduces the potential for traffic conflict or conflict points along 55. It's an ideal use for this location. It borders the railroad corridor and it's fronts on Highway 55. As I said, we have our team here to answer any questions you have. We respectfully ask for your approval of this matter and we'll try to answer any questions you have. Thank you very much.
Are there questions by members of the council on this item? Is there anyone in the public that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one else asked to speak on this item. I declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council.
Move the item.
It's been properly moved and second. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
I just wanted to take a second to say that we're seeing an amazing number of these kinds of projects and some places where I think they may not be appropriate, but I do agree with you, Mr. Gosch, that this particular site seems to be well suited for this.
Don, I was going to say the same thing. It seems like we're getting more requests for storage facilities, and I assume it means that there's demand, and I assume it means that you've got people here who are moving in apartments that don't have space, so they will use these units. I hope the demand is there, because I hate to see some of these things go down. I know this particular developer, he does a quality product, and I agree this location is a good site for it. If there are no further questions, the public hearing is closed. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
We have a consistency statement. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Move to item 23, zoning map change, the towns that South Point.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor, the Planning Department. Zoning case Z15-00042, the towns at South Point, is a zoning map change request for 8.28 acres. The project is comprised of three parcels of land located at 6,300, 6,200, and 6,304 Barbie Road. The subject site is presently zoned residential suburban 20 with a future land use map designation of low medium density residential, 4 to 8 dwelling units per acre. The applicant proposes zoning designation to plan development residential 5.918. The development plan associated with this request graphically commits to the following: general location of access points, tree coverage, location of multifamily building and parking envelope, size and location of project boundary buffers. Text commitments have been proffered. The proffered commitments will require that the developer provide a monetary contribution to Durham Public Schools, dedicate additional right-of-way, provide an undisturbed landscape buffer along the western and northern property project boundaries, provide dog waste stations, limit to the development to townhomes in the preservation of the single-family home, provide a striped crosswalk across Barbie Road, and constructing northbound left turn lane. Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 7-5 on October 11th, 2016. Staff determines this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan, other adopted plans and policies. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
Okay, we've heard the staff report. This is a public hearing. We'd ask first, are there comments by members of the council on this item? If there are no comments by members of the council, let me first see who else wants to speak. We have two persons that have signed up to speak as proponents. We have one person who signed up to speak as an opponent. Let me ask, is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item that has not signed one of these yellow cards? That being the case, let's start with the proponents, initially 10 minutes, and likewise 10 minutes for the opponents. Recognize Ken Spaulding and George Stanciel in that order.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Mayor Pro Tem, and members of the council. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant in this matter. Usually I go into the land planning aspects, but let me deal with process tonight, and then George Stanziel will deal with the actual land planning aspects. The process is this. This particular development has been before the Planning Commission on two occasions. Prior to my involvement, they had received a 12-0 vote against it. We got involved. The developer wanted to work on this further, and we agreed to, for me to represent him, move forward with it by going back to the Planning Commission, going back to the neighborhood and neighbors, and meeting with them to try to see if we could resolve the issues that caused the Planning Commission to be opposed to it and for them to be opposed to it. So we worked extremely hard. We had a meeting with them. There were about over 20 some odd people there. We went down a list with all of their concerns. We went back for the team to meet and talk about it. I received a call from Shonda Allen, who was a representative of the neighborhood. And for one of the first times in my 30 years of doing it, we had a representative from the neighborhood who wanted to sit down with the team as we worked through trying to see what we could go along with and what we were unable to. What we ended up doing, we rolled up our sleeves with Ms. Allen there, and we worked extremely hard with George and others, and we were able to create a win-win situation for most of the residents our neighbors. Now, what we were able to do was this particular development was 7.6 units an acre. We were able to reduce that down to 5.9. It was actually 62 units of the townhomes, and we were able to reduce that down to 48. We also repositioned the building to pull it further away from the closest residents that we had at that location. We worked extremely hard. They wanted to make sure that we had an attractive townhomes. So what we ended up doing, we agreed to certain architectural guidelines that satisfied them and satisfied some of the members of the Planning Commission. We went back in front of the Planning Commission. As a matter of fact, when we came back and met with the residents again, seven of them were there. Some of them afterwards told me how much they appreciated the significant compromises that we had made. There were still a very few that had indicated that they would be opposed to the development. Ms. Allen, who represented them, is not here this evening, I don't think, but she worked hard to try to get all of these matters addressed. I want to say that the Planning Commission voted, after turning it down unanimously, they voted for us to be successful in this by a 7-5 vote. We came on up to the council because we did not want to go from the Planning Commission the very first time with a vote against us and come to this council and try to work it out with the council without any regard for the neighbors. We didn't do that. We are here before you now. We meet all the policies, requirements, the comp plan. We made reductions, both traffic. We're making recommendations or commitments where we will also contribute to the school fund and the school system for the students that would be a part of our development. George, if you could take it from there.
Okay.
Good evening, members of council. George Stanziel, president of Stewart. I reside at 115 Cofield Circle. I've got a number of slides to go through. I'm going to try to go through them very quickly because I don't have much time. So I'll just move as quickly as I can. When we met with the neighborhoods, they asked us to kind of step back and look at this area in a more regional kind of way, not just look at our site. So the slide that you have before you is really looking at where our site, it kind of in context with surrounding densities. You see that they're in the five, a number of them that are in the 5 and 5.9 range, directly, for instance, right across the street from us. In the area that we looked at, the area in green that you see, 2,700 single-family homes, 529 townhomes, and over 400 apartments. So there's a, my point about this is that there's a very generous mix of housing types and housing styles and lifestyle in this general area. Moving down closer to our site, you see our site there in the middle. We're proposing 5.9 units per acre. Directly across the street, there is an apartment project that is 5.9 units per acre. Auburn Village to the north, 5.37 units per acre. These are all projects that have a mix of use, a mix of housing densities within the overall project, so that there's single family, there's multifamily, there's townhomes that are mixed within all of these developments. And you see I-40 directly to the south and Barbie Road there to the east of our site. This is our site. You can see that that in general, the homes adjacent to the site are anywhere from 100 to 200 feet from the site. We're adding an additional buffer, and the corner there up in the left-hand corner is what Mr. Spaulding was referring to, where we actually pushed our development envelope back so that the homes that were the closest to the site would have more buffer. I wanted to just show this very quickly. This is a development on Hope Valley Road. I know it very well because I live there. It's an 8-acre townhome community that is embedded in a single-family development. 8 acres, 7 units per acre, which is greater than ours. The surrounding neighborhoods have really become our friends. They like our development. We do things together. We're on the same listserv. It's a wonderful situation that we have there. And you see across the street, multifamily development, townhome development, and of course a church. So this is to me a very, very good example of how our project fits into a single family community. We had 5 meetings with the residents. We addressed their key issues. We reduced, as Mr. Spaulding said, the units from 63 to 48. We reduced the density from 7.6 to 5.9. We added a dog waste station as a committed element. The community had some concerns about walking dogs through their development and not taking care of business. So we added a dog waste station. We increased the buffer in the northwest corner, as I said, and the homes are 100 to 200 feet from our property line. We also added architectural commitments and requested by the planning commissioners, which we were happy to do. And these relate to colors, materials, multiple colors per building, and then setbacks of the buildings where the buildings aren't flat across the front, but they actually set back, each unit sets back from one another. We also were asked to conduct a traffic evaluation, and this is not a TIA, but it was an evaluation of cut-through traffic through the through the neighborhood. There was a sense that there was a lot of cut-through traffic from areas to the north and so forth. We did that that evaluation by counting cars on both ends, and we found that most of the traffic that was using that as a cut through was from within the neighborhood, and that our project would add one car every 12 minutes potentially at peak hour. So it's relatively very small impact. This project provides lifestyle choice for single people, couples, and young professionals. It allows diversity of residents close to major transportation corridors and job centers. It generates less traffic than single family at 4 units an acre, which is the low end of the comp plan 4 to 8 unit per acre range. It generates less school children than single family at 4 units of the acre. And it provides efficient use of land and public services while providing a variety of dwelling types. I'm going to run out of time here. I don't know if we can ask for a few more minutes because I want to address a couple of points that the Planning Commission brought up. Can I ask for a few more minutes?
I have a question. I'm still going to stick with the time.
Okay.
We'll come back.
Well, then I will. Okay.
All right. So unless there are questions of members of the council, we're going to move to the opponents, and
okay.
Then we can come back for questions if we have them. I'd like to recognize I have your card here. I just need to find out where it is. Persons who was opposed to this item, I can't find your card.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Mayor Bell and all the committee members and attendees here. I'm here today. My name is Kendra Edwards. I'm representing Shonda Allen, who has a personal matter, and she was not able to attend this evening. I'm here as opposing, as we have discussed before, with the Towns of South Point committee personnels and Attorney Spaulding, that we still oppose this project because of the traffic issues, as we have stated before. We are aware that there have been speed bumps added to Windcrest Road, but that does not stop people who don't live in Urban Woods or Cricket Creek from coming through the neighborhood. And I stand here to represent Urban Woods, saying that out of the 80 lots that are located within that subdivision, and being a person who grew up there since 1975 when Mr. Herndon started building those homes, and knowing that Cricket Creek used to be woods and we used to play back there. I also speak standing to oppose it because most of the people who live there now are elderly, and they're not here tonight because they don't come out at nighttime. And we did have a larger presence at the first hearing we had, and we had those people here to help represent. So I stand here to represent them, saying that we just feel that it's going to cause more traffic with all of the things that are going on. I actually went to the development tracker and pulled all the different things that are going on over there, and I own part owner with house with my mother. And I'm just looking at all the things that have transpired over the years and the development and how it has developed, but it's been a lot of traffic. I mean, there have been times where I've had to sit at Urban Woods at the entrance of Windcrest Road for 10 minutes waiting to get out in the morning to go to work or go home at night because the traffic has increased. I think that we just stand where we are, that we just don't feel that would benefit our neighborhood to have more townhomes where there are already some down the street. You have apartments here. And as you drive now to Barbie Road, you now are gonna have more townhomes on 54 and more apartments over here. And it's just gonna be more and more traffic. And I know that they said they did a traffic observation, but I just feel like for the neighborhood, for us and for the people who live there, we just feel that it's just not feasible for us to have more townhomes, more traffic. We're gonna have Duke at the Wow on our back door. That's gonna be even more traffic of people coming in, going to the doctor. And I just feel for us, it's just not gonna be a feasible thing for us. And Ms. Shonda and I talked about it before I came, and if it is approved, we ask you to help us because we've had increased crime recently. We had a neighbor to be her home to be vandalized, basically, and they went through her whole entire home. Our neighborhood is not as bright as it should be. To help us feel more secure when we're out at night, we can have our lights on, but if the street is not lit up properly, like last night when I took my mother home, I almost hit someone because I could not see them because they were in a very dark area. So we ask that if you do approve this, although we are opposing it, we're asking that if you could help us to make our neighborhood more safer by providing us sidewalks, improved street lightings. They stated that they were gonna, in one of our meetings, that they were gonna have doggy stations on the opposite side, a legacy place for people to walk across the street to walk their dogs. Well, Cricket Creek people walk through our neighborhood all the time, but they pick up their animal poo, most of them. But we can't see that being a total logical thing. We hope that they won't come through our neighborhood with their animals. We also ask that, you know, if you do approve it, that you put more speed humps through our neighborhood to help minimize how fast someone is driving. There are children playing in the neighborhood in some parts of that. But we really would just really not prefer not to have increased townhomes that increase the traffic flow within that area of our community. Thank you.
You're welcome. Are there questions by members of the council? First, let me ask, is anyone else that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? We've had opponents. Is anyone that wants to speak against the project? If not, I have some questions for the proponents, if you don't mind. No, proponents. What is the plan for exiting and entering from Barbie Road? You have all the townhomes on the, are they facing Barbie Road?
Yeah, there will be no entrances or exits into the neighborhood.
I mean, I'm talking about the plot.
But on Barbie Road, it will be one entrance exit.
When do we see that? See. I travel this road every morning, so I'm very, very familiar with it.
So just to clarify for the council, there will actually be two points of access, only one point of access for the townhomes. There will be a secondary access driveway for the single family home that is proposed to be left on site. Okay. There will be no interconnection between the townhomes and the single family driveway. If you actually look at the development plan, you'll see that the connection is shown towards the north of the site. You'll see that it aligns with existing roadway improvements. Obviously, the developer will be required to put in northbound turn lane into the development as a condition of this approval to help offset any potential traffic impacts associated directly with this project.
I guess I'm, what number is that? Which attachment number is that? What is the attachment number for the? Are these two arrows up at the top, which you show in and out, is that supposed to be the?
That is the point of access for the townhomes. It indicates a full access drive connection.
And can you tell us what type of buffer is being left between the Yellowstone Drive development, well, the urban woods development, and this is this? Are these just trees, or is it a planted buffer, or just what is it?
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Medlin, I can assist with that. The buffer of existing vegetation will be 30 feet, but we're also, along a strip of land, we're also committing to additional evergreens as well.
Additional evergreens?
Yes, sir.
I'm trying to determine the concern of the residents about the townhomes going through their property? What will be the access for the townhomes through their property?
So the access to the townhomes will be halfway between. So when you're going northbound on the Barbie Road, when you cross 40, you have the apartment driveway to the right as you cross 40. And then as you go forward to the north, halfway up to Windcrest, there'll be a left turn lane into the project. And then that section of the road, there's already three lanes of pavement. So there won't be any widening done in front of the project. We'll just be striping a left turn arrow into the site. Does that help clarify things?
And so how far off of Barbie Road will the homes actually be? I see a setback of, is it 8 feet? I'm trying to determine. Barbie Road is a narrow road, two-lane road. There's no possibility of it being widened. There are no plans for widening Barbie Road. Is that correct? Steve, are there any plans for widening Barbie Road at all?
Excuse me, I had to check with our transportation expert. Mr. Judge has confirmed there are no plans for the widening of Barbie Road at that location.
There are not. Yes. So it's a pretty narrow road, and I'm just trying to figure out how far the building's going to be set back off of Barbie Road. Is this 8 feet? Is that what it?
So along this section of the road, we have a three-lane section. It's about 37, 38 feet wide of pavement, and then we're dedicating 10 feet of right-of-way. And then, yes, per the plans, the closest that the buildings would be set to could be set to Barbie Road would be 8 feet, but that's following the standard minimum requirements of the zoning district, Mr. Mayor. I believe the right-of-way here is about 70, will be 70 feet upon the dedication of the additional right-of-way.
So what do we have along, I'm trying to envision, what's the roadway look like in front of the townhomes that are being built?
It's a three-lane section. There's three lanes, so there's...
I don't mean the Barbie Road. I mean with on the section of the property that you own. How do people get in and out? I mean, you've got... I assume these are garages that front Barbie Road or not?
No, Mr. Mayor.
They aren't. Are there any garages at all there? Are they on the back of it?
There will... We're not able to show the layout of the site, but in terms of the layout that we've provided... We've provided a driveway coming in perpendicular to Barbie Road,
yeah. And
then looping south towards the southern property line, and all of the driveways will be facing internal to this internal street that we're proposing.
So the driveways are internal to the project?
Yes, sir. There'll okay. be a, okay. we would, the plan is to develop, build a cul-de-sac internal to the site. Okay. So as you drive up Barbie Road, you may see the sides of homes, and further into the project, you'll see the rear of some homes.
Okay. Are there other questions? Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a question for the applicant. Have you all considered a proffer or a donation of any affordable housing funds to the City of Durham's Affordable Housing Fund?
Yes, Councilman Shule, and I'll get George to read it in. Yes, there is a commitment by the developer, a commitment to Durham and Durham's Affordable Housing Program to make an in lieu of payment here, to the City of Durham. George, could you read that in? And that'll be in the amount of $35,000. For this 48-unit townhome.
So it's before you. The commitment is the developer shall provide a one-time donation to the City of Durham's Affordable Housing Fund of $35,000. The payment shall be made prior to the final plat approval.
Thank you very much. I notice it's not as much as $50,000, which the last applicant provided.
But they had a lot more units.
But thank you very much. I appreciate the proffer very much. Thank you.
Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, thank you. I want to appreciate everyone that's here for this, and particularly the people who live in the community. I know that you all feel like, I know from meeting with you all and with your adjoining neighborhood, and you all feel pretty much under attack, that there's a lot of development going on out there and a lot of increases in pressure on the neighborhood. Tonight's case is about 34 units. It's about 34 rooftops, because 14 can be built there now. What's being proposed is 48, if I have my numbers correct. And so the trade-off for me is, and I think about the neighborhood, and I think about those 34 units, and I think about the fact that if this is approved tonight, it comes with buffers that if what's built on the property is the 14 homes that can be built there, there can be driveways onto Barbie Road, which is not planned in this project. There can be, they can build without buffers, so that's what I'm trying to weigh in terms of what works for the community. I know that those 34 homes, that it just seems like one more straw on the back of the camel, but there are trade-offs in not approving it. So I'm thinking that through as I'm listening to everybody tonight, and thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Recognize Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I've been impressed with this proposal mainly because they got a unanimous denial from the Planning Commission initially. And I appreciate the fact that you all went back and met with the neighbors. You still haven't convinced all the neighbors, but at least there's been a conversation about the things that you would do to satisfy the concerns that they put forth. And the concessions that were made, it's the kind of thing that I think is the kind of norm that we ought to have if indeed there is that outcry from the Planning Commission, from the neighbors, that the developers will want to take a look at what they put forth and to come back with a proposal that meets many of those concerns, to sit down with Mrs. Allen and others to at least have her to be willing to talk to you, I think is a good sign. And to be able to go back to the Planning Commission and get a total reversal, not total reversal, but a change in the voting process. And I read the comments that have come, and lots of people, I feel, didn't want to change their vote, even though they saw the proposal in a much more favorable light than they did initially. So I think this proposal is something that is good. We have a continuing flow, which is a positive thing for people coming to Durham, and they have to live some places. And I think that this kind of development that would meet a lot of the needs of young professionals is a good thing. I think that the access to Barbie Road that you've suggested would keep the flow of traffic from backing up into the neighborhood, and I think that this is something that might be good for Durham. So I applaud the things that you all have put forth. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Could someone talk to me about the development process on this property in terms of how much clear cutting would be required to make this development take place? Could someone talk to me about that? Speak to developers. And let me give you a reference point. If you go down Barbie Road towards 54, to your left at the corner of 54 and Barbie, it's like a moonscape. I mean, used to be trees, they're putting apartments up. I've seen the plans, I just hope it does something better, but my concern is the runoff that's gonna take place on that property. And I know when they did the metals across the way, that began to impact the pond down at Parkwood. So my question is, what kind of protection are we gonna have on this site to minimize runoff, or how much clear cutting are you going to be doing?
Well, there will be some clear cutting.
I understand that.
We are saving a lot of vegetation behind the units that are adjacent to the existing neighborhood. One of the things that affected the project you're talking about, the Meadows project there, is that a large majority of the project between where those, where that clearing is now and the existing neighborhood was committed to no development. So what you saw in that project was that all of the development was sort of pulled up front, and a lot of, in fact, all of the land that was behind the, there's a stream back there. All of the land from the stream back to the existing neighborhood is will be undeveloped. So it, you know, we've sort of, I guess, clustered the development up closer to the road. This project is a single road. That project has multiple roads. It's a, this is a single road, single cul-de-sac with units. We haven't done grading plans yet, so we don't know quite the extent, but we'll minimize it. It's not a steep site. Runoff, we will deal with the city and, you know, stormwater regulations that, you know, we all have to live with and are great and strict. So I you know, I know that we have a, Robert, I'm sorry, the commitment to tree save and open space is about 30% of the site that will remain, and maybe more, between 30 and 40%. So, you know, we're not intending to take down all the trees. We're intending to limit it to the development, the pieces that we have to do to get the road and the units in. Single road.
Have any comments about that, Steve?
Just for clarity, I want to make sure the council is aware that the only protected portion of this site are the areas that are shown on the development plan as undisturbed buffers.
Right.
While the applicant has indicated that there will be 30% open space, that is not a requirement. They're just going to meet the minimum ordinance standard. Beyond that, anything within the residual portion of the site potentially could be cleared and graded, and there are no additional protections to prevent that from occurring.
That's correct.
That's what gives me pause about the development. I agree that having basically two ins and outs on this is a good piece. I mean, I agree if you had single family homes all along that, all of them had, in fact, I don't even know if the Department of Transportation would allow you to have those cuts out into Barbie Road. But I am concerned about the impact that this development could potentially have in terms of runoff, not only to surrounding properties, but more importantly, to where it runs to. I'm sort of tossed on that. Seeing what I'm seeing now that's occurring around that corridor just down the way. Let me ask, are there other questions or comments on this?
Mayor, sure. Bell, can I just clarify one
sure.
thing?
Sure.
Along the western edge of the project, of our site, adjacent to the neighborhood, the way the topography works is there's actually a ridge about at the property line, just sort of east of the property line. So, to just in simple terms, our property and their property is, say, about the same elevation, but there's a ridge in between. So the drainage will go to the south end of the site, toward 40, not to the west toward the neighborhood. It's the low part of the site, so that's where the pond will be.
Let me ask, are there other questions or comments? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing and the matter's not back before the council. Entertain a motion on the item. It's been properly moved and seconded. Further discussions? I recognize the mayor pro tem.
The speaker wanted to say something.
Bill, you mentioned about the concern of the runoff for the water. I think that's what you were talking about, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct? So right now, and we mentioned that several times. Carlos Capel, who is not able to be here today, had mentioned it in one of the meetings with the developer, and because we already have problems. I live down between Cricket Creek, between Castile and Willing Circle, and we already, when it rains really, really bad, it floods in the ditch there. And it banks up into the house that's on the other side of the last house in Urban Woods, their yard floods. So all the water that comes from up from Yellowstone and it goes down and up from people's yards, it runs down. So one of the concerns that Ms. Sylvia, who will live in the back of these townhomes, her concern was that how is the water runoff from these townhouses gonna affect her home? And her also concern was, you know, was she gonna have people looking in the back of her house? She has little kids. So we do have the concern, just like you said, is that water, their water problem gonna affect us? So I thank you for mentioning that, but that is another concern of ours.
Well, did you get a response from the developers when you asked the question?
The response that I remember was that it wasn't gonna affect us like that. They just told you. But we still have that concern because, I mean, I know what it feels like to live in a unit where your water runs and your heel starts to degrade. And you no longer have a buffer or a retaining wall to keep that dirt in place. But that was what they told us, that it wasn't going to affect us because they were going to run it towards the Clemens house, and they were going to have a little drain there, and it should not affect our neighborhood. But if you look at how Urban Woods sits closer up to the back of the Clemens house where the Rollins live, that area actually is a hill, and whenever it rains, snow, sleet, whatever, that water comes down and it goes into a ditch at that area. But then you have the crest hill right at the top of Forge Road where all the water actually runs back down again. So, you know, we do have water issues. We don't have curbs and gutters, but we do have a water issue out there in our neighborhood currently. So that is another concern that we do have.
I was looking at the parcel numbers around the property. I didn't recognize Roberts or Clements. Do you live in any of these homes that are close
to the Clemens? They live on Bobby Road. But if you look at the, it's the fourth house before the empty space, because I don't know how to pull it up on the map, but on the development tracker.
Can you hold on for a minute? I'm probably mm-hmm. taking more time than my colleagues want, but mm-hmm. I really want to try to understand this. Could you pull attachment 5 up? I think that's the one that we're looking at. Is there any way you can get attachment 5 up? See.
Which map are you trying to get pulled up?
Attachment 5, the development plan, which shows the property, and then it shows the houses that are 4. Surrounding it.
So Miss Sylvia lives, so the Rollins is should be number 9.
The map up on the screen also.
You ready?
Yeah, I want to see them. I want the map that we could all see it at the same time. It's up there now.
Okay. So Miss the Rollins live in number 9. That's the last house in Urban Woods.
Okay.
And then the people who live from 11 through 16, they'll be the ones who live on the back side of these townhomes. So 13 is where Miss Sylvia lives, if I'm not mistaken. And What they explained to us is what they just explained to you, that there is the different ridges or whatever, but they still are concerned about the water running down because there won't be a retaining wall or anything to keep the dirt from going away. But as they talked about on behind the Clemens, which is on Bobby Road, they were going to have a little runoff there, and it was going to run towards 40. Well, in that area, after you pass the Rollins house, there's still a little open area where the water can still run down. It's like a little street, but it's not an open street. Mr. Herndon didn't build it so it could go out to Barbie Road. So the water still comes that way. And I know in the last big rain we had, all the water that runs from the top of the neighborhood that comes down Windcrest, Yosemite Circle, Forge Road, all of that water runs right there and it stops. Let's see, I don't have my house up here, but it stops at the end of Forge Road at the back of that property behind Castell and Forge Road. They kind of go like this, and it's my house, my neighbor's house, and another neighbor's house, and then a lady that sits on the other side of the last house on Forge Road. The water puddles right there because that's where it runs to. It's causing a lot of problems.
Let me ask the developers, because I'm really trying to understand the impact on the houses that are next to the property that's being developed. So tell me what impact in terms of runoff is your development going to have on these houses that are right adjacent to the property, houses 3, 2, 1, 16, 15, 14, 13, on down? Can somebody speak to that?
It shouldn't. If you look at that map, that line, you see that line that goes there?
What line?
That dark line, yes. That's a ridge.
That's what I couldn't understand. I don't know what these...
That's a ridge. And then Miss Sylvia's house...
Show me the ridge again, please.
Where somebody just put...
Point right on the screen, not up there. Yeah.
Point to the ridge. Care of that line there. Okay?
Okay.
All right. And then Miss Sylvia, I think, is number 11. She's 13 or 11, whichever it is. She's close to 200 feet away on the other side of that ridge. But also, the concern that was expressed, the reason it sort of died down, because our explanation is what Durham requires, that we cannot have any more runoff on our property with the development than we had before. But the benefit of what we will be able to do, Ms. Clemens' house, it was discussed, is our house. That's that single family home. That's where we're going to have the retention pond, right in that area where that is. And that's where that's drawn there, so that the water will flow south. And by it being controlled, which is not controlled now, you can just have it, it's just free flow now. But it's not going to be free flow now once we're able to develop this, because we're going to have it controlled so that it will go to the retention pond and will hold it for a certain period of time and disperse it and let it out in a periodic manner. So this should be much better than what they're having to address right now today.
Okay, I didn't see anything about a detention pond on this map that I'm looking at. You just drew it in. Is that part of it, Steve, or what?
At this juncture, the developer has not committed to a specific location on the site for retention. However, what they're describing would be consistent with the typical practice associated with stormwater retention.
So how do we ensure that once they walk away from this, if we approve it, that the detention pond is where they're showing it's going to be? The fact that you got a detention pond, I didn't see a reference to a detention pond.
Mr. Mayor, this is the low point of the site. So the natural grade falls to this point of the site. So, we can push water uphill. We can force sewer uphill with pump stations, but water always has to flow downhill. So this is the low point of the site. And if I may, I can show where the kind of the valley is on the site.
I accept that. I guess what I'm asking about is you don't have a detention pond on this map now, so when do we see that?
So after the zoning process, provided we get approved, we would submit a site plan that would be reviewed by all the departments in Durham, and at that time the detention pond would be shown at that.
And that comes back to us?
No, sir.
No, that's the point.
No, sir.
No,
It doesn't come back to us. Mm-hmm. So how do we get some assurances before it comes back to us?
Graphically, where that pond is roughly 20 feet lower in elevation than this western property.
Can you put in writing that we commit to have a detention pond located on that site to address the issues that we're talking about? Is that something they can proffer if they choose to? Or if you can, give it a word so we she can do it appropriately.
Certainly, the applicant can choose to indicate either by written text or graphic representation that the storm drainage basin would be located at the southern edge of the end of the site.
And we're willing to commit to that. I mean, it's a requirement, frankly, that we have to have a detention pond. So, and we're happy to commit to the fact that it's going to be generally in that location in the southern part of the site. But we have to have a detention pond. And it has to be on the low end of the site because it all has to drain that way. So we're happy to make a commitment if we need to. Your pleasure as to how
between
we do it.
Between the planning director and the city attorney to say what wording you need to have to at least have that comfort level that you're going to do that.
I mean, I haven't seen it done like this before, but I'm sure that we could.
So, very quickly, in other projects, developers have indicated that stormwater retention features will be located within a certain area. They can do it one of two ways. They can have a note that indicates that, written text, or they can actually show a graphic showing that. It becomes a committed element because it is shown on the development plan.
What's the note? How should the note read? We want to go ahead and move forward if we can do this.
What we can do, and I can't read it because it's so small, but we, for instance, we could commit, so I would say that the developer would commit to building a detention pond in accordance with Durham's stormwater regulations, generally located on PID 148 050 and 148046.
That's a five. I don't think that's a six. Did you take it away? Did you move it? Yeah. Okay, well, if you, huh? I thought it was 14550. Recognize the mayor pro tem.
Yeah, I really wasn't going to say anything, but I see four ladies there that I recognize. You're from Irwinwood? And I can understand why you're protective of your community because there are lots and lots of senior citizens there. And there are just fears about new people coming in and then the stormwater. As a matter of fact, I had the same kinds of concerns in my own neighborhood. I'm not voting for it. I voted against it when it came before us before, and because I can empathize with you where you are in your walk. I'm not voting for you. And you were waiting for me to say something, so she sure was.
So do we have the wording on that?
Mr. Mayor, based on what Mr. Stanziel has read into the record, I will confer with Don O'Toole to make sure that we've got the language that's consistent with what's been said on the record.
Okay, my uncomfort is basically what I said, the runoff. And I'm seeing the impact that it's having around other communities. And you've got an established community that you button up against. Mm-hmm. And I think we should try to ensure that we have as much protection as possible relative to this issue. I can't talk about who the neighbors are and that type of thing, but I can talk about the development that's going to take place on that site.
Now, we're happy to do this.
I recognize Councilman Shulman.
I just want to appreciate, Mr. Mayor, your care for this and the detail with which you approached it. It's really constructive. Thank you.
Do we have other questions? The motion's been made and seconded, I thought, and we're discussing it. Are there other comments or discussions? If not, Madam Chairperson, would recognize. Did you have something to say, Steve? Okay. Would you open the vote?
Close the vote.
It passes. Ms. McFadden, are you voting? You voting no?
Yes.
It passes 6-1 with Council Mayor Pro Tem voting no.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 6-1 with Council Member Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. You voting no again?
Let's move to item 24. I'm sorry.
I appreciate your indulgence as I veer off the agenda from time to time. I want to take just a moment because no department presents more items to us than the planning department. It's an unusual meeting where we have no cases to hear. Our next meeting is one of those rare occasions, which means that the director of planning, Steve Medlin, won't be in attendance. And because he's retiring at the end of the year, this is his last meeting. So before the room is empty, I wanted to take a moment, not let it pass without expressing my appreciation, our appreciation for Steve's tenure with the city. I've worked closely with him 6 years on the Planning Commission, now 4 years on council. He works for two managers, the city and the county. He's got 12 elected officials, and he's done it with grace, with patience, and with humor. He has a tremendous understanding of the Durham community. He has a great grasp of planning and zoning issues. His department handles a wide breadth of issues. And he's been a model of professionalism and excellent customer service. The managers are going to be hard-pressed to fill the gap he's going to leave behind. I will miss him personally, and the city and the county are going to miss his leadership. Thank you, Steve.
I really appreciate that. I've been teasing Steve about when he's leaving, but I think it's very appropriate for those comments to be made this evening. Steve, I hope the response is a attestation to how we feel about your leadership and what you've done for the city. I won't say for the city and county, as you, as Don said. You
and Mr. Mayor, for the record, we had a pre-budget meeting today with Steve, and I asked him if he was coming to the meeting on the 22nd, even though there was no items on the agenda, and he said he wouldn't miss it for the world. So we do expect him to be here.
All right. I guess that means you all can leave if you want. Can they leave, Don? Okay. Thank you. Item 24, Unified Development Ordinance, Text Amendment, Technical Revisions to Wireless Communication Facilities Regulations.
Thank you very much, Michael Stock with the Planning Department. Text Amendment TC16-00001 is a set of technical amendments to paragraph 533N Wireless Communication Facilities of the Unified Development Ordinance. These are a set of technical amendments that have been identified by staff necessary to maintain the policy direction established by the new standards that were adopted back in 2015 and also maintain compliance with applicable state and federal law. The proposed amendments are summarized as follows. They will specify existing specifying existing and intended service providers, revise the method for measuring setbacks for freestanding WCFs, revise the requirement to comply with setbacks in order to qualify as an eligible facility request, clarify the permissibility of freestanding non-concealed WCFs in RS districts and the allowable height in the RS 20 district, and also add definitions for fall zone and geographic search ring. The Joint City County Planning Committee, or JCCPC, reviewed the proposed amendments at its August 3rd meeting. The Planning Commission recommended approval 12-0 of the text amendment in October. As a reminder, City Council will be required to take two actions. The first action will be a vote on the ordinance amending the UDO, and as found in Attachment A. The second action will be the appropriate statement of consistency, and as Attachment B of your agenda packet. Staff will be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Okay, it's a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. Other comments, questions by members of the council? Hearing none, is anyone in the public who wants to speak on this item? This item being a public hearing. Let the record reflect that no one in the public asked to speak on this item either for or against. I declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote?
Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Open the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move to item 25, Unified Development Ordinance, text amendment, historic preservation and other general process changes.
Thank you again, Michael Stock with the Planning Department. Text amendment TC 16004 is a text amendment also initiated by the Planning Department to make corrections, clarifications, and reorganize sections of the Unified Development Ordinance related to historic preservation, certificates of appropriateness, and review and notification procedures for various other applications. The Joint City County Planning Committee also reviewed this proposed amendment at its August meeting, and the Planning Commission recommended approval at its October meeting, 11-1. And again, two actions will be required, one on the ordinance itself, that is attachment A, and the second action would be on the statement of consistency, which is attachment B in your agenda packet. Again, staff will be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Are there questions by members of the council? Is there anyone in the public that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one in the audience asked to speak. I declare the public hearing to be closed. The matter is directed to the council. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you. Move to item 26, consolidated annexation item, Triangle Church.
Well, thank you, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. This is a request for a utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation, and initial zoning. Received from the Triangle Church of Christ. This is for three contiguous parcels, generally located at 2101 Page Road, comprising 22 acres. This represents an extension of the existing city limit. The subject site is currently vacant. The applicant has submitted a site plan for review for a potential place of worship, assuming that the parcel is annexed, and pending approval of a minor special use permit from the Durham Board of Adjustment. The Public Works and Water Management Departments performed a utility impact analysis for the site, which indicated that the existing City of Durham water main has capacity to serve the project, and the Budget Management Services Department performed a fiscal analysis, which determined that the proposed annexation will likely be revenue positive immediately upon annexation. Staff has no issues with the application as it's presently proposed and recommends that the council approve the utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation petition, and initial zoning map change request. And I'm happy to answer any questions that the council may have.
Thank you. The public hearing is open. Do you have questions, members of the council, of staff, on his report? Is anyone in the audience that wants to speak on this item, either for or against, comments? Let the record again reflect that no one asked to speak. I would declare the public hearing to be closed. Madam Clerk, for the council. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
And finally, item 27. I'm sorry. Open the vote. Open the vote. Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
The next item is a Duke Hospital addition. This is a quasi-judicial matter. And there's certain procedures that we follow. I would ask the staff to introduce this matter. And if there are witnesses, persons that want to speak on this item, you have to be sworn in. If you go to the clerk's desk, which is to the left, be sworn in. And any written information, maps that you may want to be considered as evidence should be given to the city attorney and also to persons who may be in opposition to this item. And when I say in opposition, I don't have any persons who have signed up as opponents, but let me ask for the record, is there anyone that is in the audience that is opposed to this item, that wants to speak but has not signed up? Ms. Turner, for the record, reflect that no one asked to speak as an opposition. So we'll move forward. Those persons have been sworn in. Let me ask, are there any conflicts of interest by members of the council that you know of on this particular item? Again, let the record reflect that no council members indicated they had a conflict of interest on this item. So I would ask for the introduction of the item.
Thank you. Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. The item before the council is a, there's two items. One is a major special use permit. The other is a major site plan. These have been received from Duke University for an expansion of existing hospital structure. Generally located at 2301 Irwin Road. The university proposes an approximate 500,000 square foot, 13-story addition at the subject site. The quasi-judicial hearing is for the major special use permit only, and it is required as the applicant proposes to exceed the 120-foot height limitation for structures within the University College Zoning District. The applicant is proposing a building height of 145 feet. The site plan associated with this request is included in your packet. If the council is so inclined to approve the major special use permit, then staff would request that the council act on the major site plan as well. At this time, staff has no issues with the major special use permit, nor the major site plan as they are presently proposed, and finds that the site plan meets all applicable requirements of the Unified Development Ordinance pending approval of the use permit. And I'm happy to answer any questions that the council may have at this time regarding this request.
I should have also asked the attorneys who represent this case if you could just come to the microphone and state your name, if their attorneys are representatives of the site.
And Mr. Mayor, if I may, I apologize. I'd also just like to ask that the staff report be submitted as part of the record with any necessary corrections.
So noted.
Thank you.
If you could just state your name and address as your representative.
Yes. I am Walter Havner. I'm a landscape architect in Durham with Surface 678. My address is 402 Hoganwood Circle, Chapel Hill, North Carolina. I am here today just really to answer questions that the council may have.
Fine. Let me ask other questions by members of the council on the staff report that's been presented. That being the case, then does the applicant have any items that he wants to present as a part of
this? No, sir. Just here to answer questions.
Let the record reflect that the applicant had nothing to present. He was here strictly to answer questions. Are there any questions of the council, by the council of the applicant? Again, is there anyone that is opposed that has questions of the applicant? Let the record reflect, in both cases, there were no questions asked by either the council or any person in the audience of the applicant. I'm going to close the testimony and would ask other recommendations specifically by the city staff.
Certainly. Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. The staff recommends approval of the major special use permit and the major site plan.
Recommendations by the staff. Let me say the council, if you don't have any more discussions, has two motions. One would be to grant the permit with the conditions as stated on the staff's recommendation. Or two, you can deny the permit with a decision, direction to the administration prepare a decision for denial with supporting reasons for the next council meeting. Or three, you can grant the permit with additional conditions besides those of the staff's recommendations. With direction that the administration prepare a decision to grant permit for the next council meeting. I would ask which motion, if any of the three, does someone want to make a motion to grant?
I will move that we approve the permit with the conditions that the staff recommended.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Let me ask, does the staff have any questions about the recommendation of the council?
Jacob Wiggins of the Planning Department, no, sir.
Let the record reflect that the staff had no questions of the council's recommendation of the motion. That being the case, I'm going to ask the clerk to open the vote and close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Mr. Mayor.
Site plan.
Mr. Mayor.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
After consideration of the evidence offered tonight, I want to move that we approve the major site plan as presented.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Is there further questions, discussions on that item? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay, that concludes that item and all items on the council. Are there any other items that the council wishes to bring forth at this time? If not, the meeting's adjourned at 8:51 p.m. Thank you.